All right, why don't we go ahead and get started. For those straggling in the back there, we're going to do a CTO panel. So we have some of our top CTOs inside the company that are going to talk about some of the direction for where Cisco's going. As opposed to me reading off what I'd like you to do, panel, can we start, Dave, with you and just talk about who you are and what you do? And
hey, I'm Dave Ward. I'm the CTO of the engineering group and chief architect of the portfolio.
Great. John?
Hi, I'm John Apostolopoulos. I'm John Apostolopoulos, and I'm CTO for the enterprise segment, and I also lead an innovation labs effort that goes across Cisco. I'm part of Dave's team.
Hi there, I'm Maciej, Kranz. I run the corporate technology group. We focus on identifying major technology disruptions and turning them into businesses.
Hi, I'm Sam Samuel from the Mobility CTO office. We're working on virtualizing the packet core and other critical applications for service providers.
Hi, I'm Ken Owens, I'm the CTO of Cisco Cloud. I'm Cisco Cloud, the marketplace, and a lot of the API frameworks that deployed into the infrastructure, the marketplace, and applications on the cloud.
Great. Okay, so why don't I start off, and I'm just going to throw this question out to all of you. What are some of the key technologies that you're working with that you think could be interesting to developers? And I'll just take it random. Whoever wants to take the question, go ahead. Great. Okay,
so,
thanks.
So from my perspective, cloud is relatively new to the service provider environment. Normally we've had closed boxes that we've managed to sell to people and people use them. The cloud allows us to be more virtual, which means we have more flexibility in what we do. And added to that is the DevOps model that comes with it. So there's APIs on both ends. One that's already been mentioned by Ken in terms of what OpenStack can do. But more interestingly, at the top end of it is how we intermix other services with applications that we provide. I think that's one area that I think we will be expanding on an awful lot.
So maybe I'll mention two examples. One is fog, which is what our teams are working together on, our distributed cloud. So when you think about cloud and there's a mist of fog around, so there are a bunch of use cases, like a connected vehicle is one, or an auto rig, where sometimes you can't take all the data generated by the sensors into the cloud and process them there, where you would need to actually process the data as close to the source of the data. So we've been working on the architectures that allow for data analytics and application hosting in these environments, like in the car, like on the auto rig. There are also huge security implications in these scenarios of Internet of Things, Internet of Everything, where you need interesting architectures that combine the onboard units, for example, in the vehicle with the cloud architectures as well. And it has huge implications from a developer's perspective because you need to think about much more of a real-time environments and much more of a resource-constrained environments than in a traditional cloud infrastructure.
Great. John?
Yeah, so there are quite a number of different efforts which my team's working on that is relevant to developers. One of them that I think is relevant to everybody in this room is we all have these devices. Hello, can you hear me? Okay. And we're all used to have location-based services outdoors. We want to have location-based services indoors. Maybe I'll borrow your... Or is this working now?
See, this wireless thing is not reliable.
Yeah. Thanks, Maciej.
Yeah, so we're all used to location-based services outdoors, and we want to have location-based services indoors through Wi-Fi and so forth. One of the platforms we have is Connected Mobile Experience, which was used, for instance, here at the hackathon. And many of the developers here, and many of you perhaps, try to build on top of it and build applications which can help track people and help provide context-based services to individuals indoors. So that's one example. And if there's more time later, I can go into quite a number of other different technologies where developers are really critical for us in the future.
Dave, are you good? Okay. You know, I'm going to ask this. I'm going to try to bring the crowd in here though, a little bit.
Okay.
Mix it up.
You have scarves, Nick? Rick?
Scarves. Well, I know this guy, so I'm going to pick on him. So it's unfortunate if you know me, right? So Philippe's been one of our long-term developers. So you just heard what these guys have to say. I'm going to buy him beers later tonight, so this will be worth that picking him up. So yeah, I know you do a ton of development.
Yeah, something about coherence of API. So we used to deal with MediaSense APIs, UCM APIs, SIP, and so on. And is there any plan to merge some these kind of APIs into one single framework of development, basically?
So on, pardon me, on the collab side, the merge of the APIs, you're going to see through the Squared platform that we just announced last December. So as we merge all of those products of our portfolio together, whether it's IM or it's conferencing, video, et cetera, and you're going to see the merge of those APIs and the ability to actually construct whole services via Squared. And so that's really the effort. With the existing products we have now, we continue to evolve those APIs and platforms. And you can think of it more as API aggregation, being able to, again, up-level an abstraction of a platform on top of the multiple API services and platforms that exist with Jabber or WebEx or Telepresence.
Yeah, I think it's a recognition, and I maybe stepping back a little bit. You know, it's been an interesting learning experience for us as a company. It took us a while, to be honest, to realize that you as developers actually don't want to be networking experts. You just want to get the right information for your application. So as Dave mentioned, I think we are now implementing that concept that you need 7, 10, 11 APIs, not 10,000 CLI commands, right? And it goes from collaboration. You have a Cisco One framework, an ACI, that are basically based on these principles, which is us understanding what environments and what calls you actually need and what you want to use, and us providing you this information versus assuming that you need to become the networking experts.
Yeah, so just following on from that, one of the things that's notably absent from what we do is that if you look at the service provider network itself, it's very difficult to get into for very, very good reasons. So if we can build off that set of APIs that are coming through that can allow you to program in a much more effective way, then that has a twofold benefit. One, it helps us, it helps the SP innovate at the same rate as everybody else. I think that's a crucially important thing. And also it allows things that are like Internet of Things to have more accessibility to things like service provider networks, which they need to extend the reach anyway. Right, so I think it's a very important part of that API richness that we need.
Right. Great. Any other questions right now? Anybody have anything burning here? If not, I'll keep going. All right, Maciej, can you tell us a little bit about the innovation centers? I know that's a big effort. What do we got going on there?
Sure, I can get started on this one. So this is actually, so how many of you have heard of Internet of Everything innovation centers?
Of course.
Perfect, yep. Great. So this was a concept very much tied in with the discussion we're having around DevNet. The idea here is, we need to focus on co-developing with the customers, with partners, with developers, with startups, research institutions. And we need to co-develop not where we happen to be, but where you are. So we started developing, and actually, Dave, you've been sponsoring that effort, we started developing these innovation centers around the globe. We announced 7 of them so far that are focused on 3 things. One is to showcase the solutions that and best practices and capabilities that we jointly have developed. Second one, probably more importantly, developing joint solutions with customers and partners. Thirdly, to focus on investments. So we started a lot of investment teams around the developers community, and last but not least, the research relationships. So in Europe, we've so far announced several centers. So one in Berlin will be up and running this September, in Barcelona, in London, and there are more coming. And what's interesting about these centers is, Dave, you've talked about the Dev Innovate, and there's a pod there, right? Each of these centers actually are getting this Dev Innovate platform deployed, which basically means that whether you are in Berlin, whether you're in Barcelona, London, or anywhere else, you can come in and have a consistent, latest and greatest underlying infrastructure and the latest application developer framework that you can develop on. And down the road, we will also be leveraging also the work that Ken is doing around the cloud capabilities as well. So this is, the bottom line, innovation centers are the key element of our DevNet strategy of providing you, the developers, with the infrastructure around the world to develop with us the joint solutions.
Hey, so Maciej, are they all the same? Do you have, if you go to Paris, is it the same as London or Berlin or Barcelona or whatever? Are there themes or what's going on?
Great question. So each of these centers actually have their own focus area and theme. So for example, the center in Berlin is focused on manufacturing and transportation, which makes sense. You know, Central Europe has a strong, strong history of innovation in these areas. And Berlin is taking actually a global role on developing and prioritizing solutions in this in these markets. In London, for example, we focus a lot on oil and gas, on urban development, again, for similar reasons. But the beauty of this is by leveraging the scalable, both the local infrastructure as well as the cloud infrastructure that Ken is driving, regardless of where you are, if you are in Berlin, you can develop solutions in manufacturing that can be deployed then in Latin America or in North America or in Asia. So it's the best of both worlds.
Maciej, is it just an incubator? Is it an office? Is it staffed with engineers? What goes on in an innovation center?
Another good question, Dave. So it's a combination of all of those. And by the way, we didn't practice that, so Dave is surprising me with questions in case. But they're all great questions. So it's a combination of both, which is you have basically folks that would allow you to go in and get training on the latest technology. You also have the lab where you can go in and actually code on the latest products. But it's also the you have developers, like for example in Paris, Alan's team, right? Where these are the folks who are actually developing the products, develop the code, developing the architectures. So you can interact not only with people that help you with developer infrastructure, but with the actual developers who are developing the real code.
Great. And so if I'm Philippe, I'm in Belgium, and I want to get engaged, and I want to go to Berlin, or I want to go to Paris, how do we get a hold of you or your staff?
Please don't get a hold of me, because that spells trouble. But. It's actually a great question. There is on the website, on cisco.com website, you have all the innovation centers listed and the contact information is there.
Great.
And if you can get a hold of these guys, then please call me, right? But some of the innovation center teams are actually present here. So you would see the team from London, from Berlin, and other teams. They are on the DevNet floor here. So when you leave this panel, please go and chat with these guys.
That would be great. And then, you know, the other thing is everything that is here is on developer.cisco.com. And obviously we're linking off to the innovation centers. But if you don't know the URL for the innovation centers, just come. I mean, you only have to remember one thing, developer.cisco.com, and we'll get you to the right people.
Okay. Exactly.
Great. So,
but our doors are open, so please come in.
All right. So we talked about, you know, innovation centers where you can come and learn and start to engage. So we've got a lot of networking people. So how many people are here on the networking area that are interested in networking? Okay. So a few. I would assume it's a Cisco conference. Maybe you can talk a little bit about what are some of the types of skills and the things that we think that people who have a networking background need to get to transition to the software world. And then maybe extend, what are we doing for that group? And I'll leave that open too. What are some of the skills? What do the people have to do? And what? How are we helping them get there?
So Ken, actually, why don't you take that one, because you're trying to make it easier. And how does CCS actually target both networking folks as well as apps?
Yeah, definitely. So I'd say there's a couple of ways to look at networking coming into more of a developer model. Pretty much every networking individual understands, you know, iOS or NextOS, some type of a scripting language. And that's really the first step in developing, right? If you understand kind of how to configure something with the command line, it's really just taking that knowledge and then how do I apply that to software, a software model, and look at this as a abstraction layer. I want to connect these multiple points together. Here are the commands I would type along the way to do that. How do I make a software program that will allow that same configuration to occur, but at a software abstraction layer, not actually talking to the underlying device? So that's one way that I think about the change. The other way is, when you think about cloud computing, specifically to Dave's question, it's all about abstracting the underlying infrastructure, right? Infrastructure is very important. The network is very key, and the data that's on that network is the key to, you know, any successful application, right? But what's interesting to a developer is they really don't want to understand, to the point Rick made at the beginning, that you don't want to dive deep into each of those individual layers and have to command, you know, 5,000 lines of code to every single device to try to configure end-to-end configuration. So there are lots of training programs. I know DevNet has some programs. If you look at the way you can go into you know, OpenStack and start learning some of the Neutron API language, it will help you sort of see how you can configure the network into different places. BIC, which is our network SDN controller, will give you a view of the SDN configuration and how that plugs into Neutron. Yeah. And so there's a couple of different ways to sort of become more aware of programmability of the network, and not just the cloud, but in even Cisco components that we have on DevNet. Right.
So Ken, on that, it might not be clear that what are the different layers of the stack that you make visible to any developer that comes to InterCloud or to CCS?
Yeah, definitely. So from a layer standpoint, we expose everything from the Neutron stack, which is the network layer. Neutron consists of all the underlying switches, all the underlying network ports on the server, and all of the scheduling algorithms around how do you go from point A to point B in the most optimal route. And so all the routing layers are exposed through that Neutron layer. The compute layer is also exposed, and so if you're trying to do just local configuration and local, you know, load balancing of a group of servers, we expose all of the underlying network components, the firewall, the load balancing, any kind of port configuration that's needed on the actual physical server that your application's running on. So that's kind of the physical layer. And then from the application layer, we expose the services. So the, you know, any kind of memcache, any kind of RabbitMQ that you need, any kind of DNS configuration, any sort of load balancing configuration that the application itself wants to configure is all exposed through the API layer as well.
So
1 sec, Rick. Actually, for skills, what about somebody that wants to get into fog computing? I mean, you're coming out of the network, you run a, you know, you're running wiring closets, you're running wireless access points or ISRs, whatever the case might be in an enterprise, but now you want to get into fog computing and start running some software out there. What does somebody do, John? What do they need to learn?
Yeah, so like the variety of things which Cisco has built in order to make this even easier. So many of you already use Linux, for example. One of the things we're building at Cisco is something called IOX, which takes iOS, the networking software we build, and ties it with Linux. And Linux, as you know, is one of the areas where, obviously, it's open source, but also the huge number of drivers and other functionality which has already been written and which can now be leveraged, which you can leverage, to build your applications on top of the network and stack iOS, and therefore to build applications that can work at the edge of the network, what we call here fog. That's one example. Something I want to mention, too, which is really, really useful, is the sandbox, which DevNet has. Because with the sandbox, what happens is you can remotely get access to a lot of the software platforms we have, and you can program them. And not only the software platforms, but you can actually get access to a lot of the hardware. So instead of you going and buying some switches and routers and so forth to have your own testbed, you can reserve some time on the DevNet sandbox to actually get access to the hardware, to configure it, to program it, to play with it, to learn it, to see, does this solve your problem? And if yes, great. You can then go buy and build those solutions yourself. If not, you can try out some other things there. So I think the DevNet sandbox is incredibly useful, and I highly recommend for you to go in and play with it.
Great. Thank you for the shameless plug. And there is a booth over there that has the sandbox services, so you can learn about how you get a lab in there that's in the cloud, running on CCS, by the way. So we're running out of all our infrastructure. And you can get a shared lab, reserve lab, and do testing and certification if you're an ISV. I want to go back to InterCloud for a bit, because I want to tie off on that conversation. Who would use InterCloud? Is it straight for ISVs? Is it the enterprise developer? And how would it differ? Because I think, let me show a hand. So who's here from an ISV? I know, Philippe, you are, right? Anybody else work for an ISV? So we have a couple of ISVs. How many people work are enterprise developers? Any enterprise developers working in IT? Okay, so we got a couple here. So how does it differentiate, and who would use some of the InterCloud stuff if you're an ISV or an enterprise developer?
Yeah, definitely. I would say that the InterCloud is made for all developers. We're not really trying to cater to any one specific type of developer, but all developers. ISVs have a kind of a special place in the InterCloud, if you will, because we have a lot of partners that are ISVs, and so we've kind of carved out a very easy experience for the ISV to get up and running in our cloud. Both from a help you get your software up and running in a cloud standpoint, and from developing from scratch and kind of doing a CI/CD tool chain integration to your existing development framework. So we give you both options in the InterCloud. The nice thing about that is InterCloud is kind of a cloud of clouds, and so you're not just developing for the Cisco cloud. You're developing for Cisco's cloud, all of our partner clouds, that and anything that Cisco powered is a partner cloud. And we also integrate with Amazon, Microsoft, and Google. And so you don't get locked in to just Cisco. You're actually being deployed across the globe. We're live on Telstra in Australia. There's other ones in Europe that we're coming up on in the next few months. And so it truly is a global cloud that's meant to allow your application to run closest to your users. And so if your user base is in Germany, we're going to have a really good partnership with DT for Germany. So you got your data sovereignty. You have your isolation of your networking and all your support coming from Germany. There'll be no worry about Snowden type of effects of things coming from the U.S. to take your data out. And so those are the kind of things that we're just building into the platform. And from an enterprise developer standpoint, we have both a bridge to kind of get from the enterprise to the InterCloud. So we're very much focused on that hybrid cloud scenario. And so if you're an enterprise developer, and you want to put some of your code out into your public-facing interface out into the InterCloud, we have a nice, easy way to, same way, integrate to that CI/CD tooling that you have in the enterprise, or even your legacy. If you're using like Jenkins and some of the older type of development framework, we can plug into your existing development framework and allow you to just push it to the cloud. And in that cloud, in our cloud, we have, we're supporting OpenShift, we're supporting Cloud Foundry, and we're supporting, some of the normal tools like Vagrant and Console from HashiCorp. And so we're trying to be very much integrating to the tooling and the systems that developers like to use, and we're not trying to force you to some new framework. And so if you're, wherever you're at today works in our cloud, if you're looking at moving to something that's more cloud native, we support cloud native as well. And so we're trying to sort of cater to the developers where they're at and help them get to that CI/CD, continuous integration, continuous delivery into a cloud environment that's global in nature, not just locked into one single enterprise-focused type of company.
Okay, so you're helping them develop, and then Maciej, I'm going to come to you on this question too, so get ready. So, okay, they're developing, it's exciting, we got some ISVs out here. Anything, kind of what's in it for them? Why work on Cisco? Are we doing anything to help them get to market or anything? And can you talk a little bit about that?
So we have a marketplace, which is very...
So you can talk about that.
It's very helpful, We have APIs for the marketplace.
All right.
And so in the same environment as everything else here, even from developer, you know, .cisco.com, hopefully in the next few months we'll get that working out. But the idea is that you would be able to come to one place, develop your code, hit a push button to the marketplace, and it goes into the Cisco InterCloud Marketplace. Once you're in the Cisco InterCloud Marketplace, you're now available to be deployed anywhere in the world that we have partners and are connected to other sites.
Okay, so you're here, you're going to hear about future. So this, you can't get to it today, but that is a future. So that's new, you know, for your ISVs, this marketplace, this whole idea and concept is going to be new. So you're going to want to check back and
And if you're in a marketplace today, you don't have to move. We're going to federate to the most popular marketplaces, so AppDirect, Parallels. You know, we're not going to try to force you to leave. If you're in a marketplace today, that's fine. Keep pushing your code there. We're going to federate with other marketplaces and pull all of that goodness together into one place.
Okay, so I'm going to shift from the cloud. I'm going to go back to the physical infrastructure, right? So you have some ISVs, sticking with the ISVs out here. Anything that the innovation centers do for me out to get out to market? I'm a small startup company. I hear what I'm saying. I like the technology. I come to the innovation center. I develop. What can I do with the innovation center? How can the innovation center help me get out there?
Great question. And I think that if you're an ISV, innovation center was designed for you also, in addition to developers. And I think that the basic concept here is let's focus on developing the joint solution that we can take to the market globally. So let's say if you are in Toronto and you develop, let's say, with a local customer, we would not only help you develop the solution, but we will work on certifying it. If it makes sense also, we would integrate your components as part of our packaging, and our Salesforce can take it to market. So so the benefit for you as an ISV is that once you've actually designed the solution with us, our Salesforce can help you sell it.
Excellent. Okay. So I'm going to do another little shift again, and I'm going to start, because we had some networking people, and I want to move into software-defined networks a little bit. And talk about open source. So how important is open source to Cisco? What are we doing with open source, especially in the area of network? I'll throw that out to the group, whoever wants to take that.
Hugely important.
Okay, so we have, Sam, tell me about why is it hugely important.
Okay,
if you could speak up a little
bit.
Yeah,
sure. So there's a very good reason why open source is hugely important to us. Most of the feedback I've got from talking to service providers is that we need to be able to move the standardization process forward faster. We're held back because we've got a 5 or 6 year cycle for standardization, which is understandable. But now you've got to view the need to innovate at a different pace, and we have to compromise that with the standardization process. Another way of standardizing is through going through open source. So moving to the cloud, virtualization is a very important thing to do inside the SP area. Being able to do that through things like OpenStack is supremely important. It gets us to move to those platforms much faster, which means you get the benefit of the innovation much quicker. So from that point of view alone, you know, open source is very, very important. Furthermore, if we really want to get the programmable network, then having the APIs that go to the open source is another way of doing it, and expanding those is a very good way of doing it as well. Right? And then, of course, we've got to make sure that works its way into the inevitable standardization process that goes on, but you're not hampered by that delay anymore. I think that's one of the critical things.
So Sam, the mobile network, you know, has been dominated by a standards body that you mentioned, that you've talked about or alluded to before, but it's 3GPP, a giant standard organization that produces multi-volume encyclopedias of standards, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah. But there hasn't been a major open source move in mobility. but there are around tools and toolkits, but where's, you know, the community around developing mobility solutions?
So that's a very interesting point. So I'm going to drag the conversation back a little bit, back to Intercloud, and I'm going to put a supposition to you all, which is if you have virtualized pieces of equipment that are in a catalog that you can instantiate, and you have something like Div Innovate that you can go and play with, and you have new skills that look at declarative modeling as the main approach to doing end-to-end services, and you can program at that level, then you have a means to manipulate any kind of mobile network that happens to be around. And you can test new applications and services on those. By doing that, you start to push, to today's point, the 3GPP standards a bit faster than they are, because you need to have more controllability over them, open them up, and so on and so forth. Some of that is subsumed by the way you actually stand things up. So that is where the open source, things like OpenStack start to come into their own, because then you're actually programming at that level to make sure all your virtualized functions are being able to be manipulated and configured at a more programmatic level. I think that's the big difference. So yes, the standards interfaces will be there, but the means of manipulation is something I think the open standards, open sources will allow you to be more fresh with.
So John, on the open source piece, in the world of IoT and the evolution of those protocols and those platforms, open source also is a play, but there are much different standards bodies, open source communities than Linux or something like that. What are some of the main ones that folks want to follow?
Yeah, so there are quite a number of different efforts in IoT related to open source and standardization in general. And what happens is it's often associated with the different verticals. So for instance, we're all familiar, or we've all heard about smart grid. Okay, smart grid is an area where the idea there is to have wireless mesh networks to connect information about water, electricity, gas, and so forth, bring them together. There's some parts there which are government regulated for obvious reasons, but also various opportunities there to leverage all kinds of open source capabilities to build these solutions. For example, the IPv6 stack that's used in some of these mesh networks, as well as some of the low power wireless that's used in these mesh networks, those are often developed by the OpenStack community. By the open source community. And this is then used by the various groups to actually build the solutions that are out there. So what you see here is a case where there's actually some verticals which are really important for society. And these verticals are actually leveraging a lot of networking technology and network stacks and so forth, which are developed by the open source community to build these solutions. So there are many opportunities for open source in the IoT space. And this is just even going to increase as we talk about smart buildings, smart cities, and so forth, where various sorts of capabilities from OpenStack to Open Daylight, which we should talk about, come into play and enable us to build the solutions there. Keep in mind that things like containers, which are very important in Linux now, are something which is going to be critically important to build applications on top that run, for instance, in Fog or run in OpenStack to enable these applications. Should we talk a little bit about Open Daylight? Because I think that's...
Sure, we should, because that's where all the cool people are. and that's where the cool community is, certainly for networking engineers. Because it's emerged as the industry's open source SDN controller platform. It speaks every SDN protocol known to mankind and has a vibrant community around it. It's of all the Silicon Valley players plus other large companies. And you're seeing not only the infrastructure now being completed through a couple of releases, but applications being built to automate stuff that everybody does every day, but also provide solutions. So that's a critical community. And OpenNFV.
Okay, cool. So
just Rick, if I can add to that one thing. So on when you think about open source, we're not just fans of open source, we're developing open source. And so everything we create, especially when it comes to the cloud infrastructure, the application acceleration things we're developing, we're contributing all of that back to the communities that we're involved in. So we're not just sitting back and taking open source code, we're contributing open source code back into the environment. And as things around the network acceleration, network policy control, and probably the most important to this group is the API components that make developing applications easier in the cloud. So those three areas are very big contributions that we're making today.
Great. Yes.
Hi. One of the common concerns that we hear expressed from some of our partners and customers about open source is whether we can trust the code and whether it is secure to use open source. What are your thoughts about that?
Oh, okay. Mike, can I on that one? So that's an excellent question. It comes back to the question that Dave asked about standardization. There's a view, so I'll just ask you, right? So if you use something like Ubuntu, usually go for the long-term support version, so 14.1, right? So I think in the SP world, you'll go down the same sort of route, or potentially could go down the same sort of route, that you're going back to the long-term support version of it because most of the bugs have been worked out in that particular release. So as we move towards etc/NFV, there is an opportunity here to say that we can advance the standardization because we've adopted the long-term support of, say, OpenStack, and we've adopted the long-term support of, say, OVDL. That moves the ball forward much, much faster than waiting for a standard to be written. Okay. So that's a pragmatical way of doing it. I think it helps you guys in the community much more because then you know what the APIs are, what the reliable APIs are, and what kind of behavior you expect to get from those APIs. That's one way of moving things forward.
And I know one thing that you know we do at Cisco that I recommend you all do is never trust software, ever, right? And so we security code review every single piece of code that goes into our environment on a quarterly basis. We do penetration testing on a weekly basis, and that is weekly. That's a pain to do, but it's important because you get vulnerabilities hourly, right? So if you don't know what's happening in your environment and you wait till the end of the quarter to do a test, there's no telling how long you've let something live inside your environment. And so we test our environment, and I would recommend you test your environment often because the most vulnerable thing in the world is the software we all trust every day on our laptops, right? And so if that's vulnerable, you can bet there's other things out there that are vulnerable. So trust but verify everything that you have running in your environment.
Great. Any other questions from the group? So this is the opportunity for you to ask stuff that maybe even is in public. So we learned about Marketplace that wasn't announced, right? We learned about some of the things we're doing on open source. We're learning about these new innovation centers. Any questions for the group on things that you want done or you want to know about in the future? Yes.
You've talked a lot about APIs and how you know that makes it easy for developers to get going and the infrastructure, things like cloud services and so on. But a lot of these things only really come to life when they've got data and real data flowing, like collaboration solutions. So you need real data, you need real things. What is Cisco doing there to help sort of create the data that you know in these sandboxes and so on that will help developers really you know see their applications with real you know real life scenarios happening through them?
So John, why don't you take this and talk about data in motion a little bit on some of the data that's coming out in the analytics, the data collection platforms and then the analytics platforms on top of that.
Sure. Yeah, so what happens as we know in IoT as well as many other areas, data and understanding the data to be able to take actions is critically important. One of the things that we are building is something called data in motion, and you can learn about it over here and was used in the hackathon. Maybe you've already played with it, I'm not sure. But what happens there is you have the ability to actually look at the data streams. Well, you can install data in motion, which is essentially some software capabilities on, for instance, an ISR in the future or UCS, an x86-based platform or an ARM-based platform, and then be able in real time to look at all the streaming data coming in, understand that data, take actions. You can send that data to the cloud for additional big data gathering and processing, or you can take actions locally, or you can do both. And it's a very powerful capability to use. And some of the advantages that it has, the ability to look at the data and look at the data locally to where it's generated, is you can often take actions much, much faster than if you send the data to the cloud. So it's faster, it provides higher scalability, and also in certain cases, high reliability, because if your connection to the cloud goes down, you can still do the processing locally.
So also towards developers in both our sandbox as well in the virtual internet routing lab, where there's a development environment as well on top of networking kit, there's virtual traffic generators to produce the data that's necessary to respond to as you're writing an application. So in the sandbox, is in Viral, we give you the tools as well to recreate
the physical environment into the virtual environment, those sandboxes, to be able to respond in your code properly.
Cool.
And just to add to that, you know, Dave mentioned Project Squared earlier. That's running on our cloud. And so we have Project Square, we have energy, connected mobility solutions running on our cloud, we have EnergyWise running on our cloud. And so we're putting Cisco applications and some of the innovation things that we're doing into our cloud and collecting, taking that data and exposing it through APIs for you to then write applications using that data.
So Ken, towards that, in InterCloud as well, you have both test sandboxes in production, as you mentioned, with the marketplace. And so as you're in test, you actually can generate that data, you can respond to those alarms,
exactly.
You can set up those sessions long before you actually move it over to a production environment.
And it's the same environment, right? It's just the way the policies you put around your sandbox may be different than what you put around a production deployment. But you're not rewriting your code. When you test it into cloud, you're testing it in your production environment eventually. It's the same software, the same underlying infrastructure. So you don't have to try to port your code to some other environment.
Okay. Hey, thinking about things that people could take advantage of here. So John, you mentioned hackathons. You mentioned hackathons, right? We just had a hackathon at Cisco Live Milan here over the weekend. You don't have to wait for Cisco Live, because Maciej, you guys do hackathons all the time at the innovation centers, right? So you can come to Cisco Live, any Cisco Live, and do a hackathon, and that's great in one central area, you know, three times a year, right? The magic hackathons, what do you guys do?
Exactly, and I think that when you think about hackathons, it's not just a fun event, but it's an opportunity for you to play real time with the latest technology and the latest interfaces. And as Rick mentioned, in addition to the opportunity like here, when you can go and do it over the weekend, we are working on the same concept for innovation centers. So. Every quarter, when you go to London or Berlin, we'll run the hackathon that is focused on bringing ISVs, developers, startups, and entrepreneurs to experience what we have as greatest and latest. And they're usually themes. So for example, you would have a theme around, let's look at the data. Let's look at the application hosting in different environments. Let's look at integration with the third-party applications in the cloud. So it's designed in a way that you should be able to come into every hackathon and actually learn something new, experience the new environment, and hopefully enrich your offerings in the process.
Great. So
and I found with hackathons that, like, there's been a couple of projects I've worked in that we'd spend a month kind of trying to figure out or brainstorm a solution, and we would have a good idea in our head of how it should work, and we'd have some working code. But then we'd come together for a 24-hour hackathon, and it would be a much better design and solution. And the best part is just actually working, running code that does what you want it to do at the end of that 24 hours. And every team I've been on has said, why didn't we just start with the hackathon? Why did we spend this month, you know, talking and thinking about this when we could have just actually done it? And so it's definitely helps you get from idea to this is working, running code that we can take to the market right now.
Cool. All right. So this could be the last question here, and I'll open up to the group. So we've talked a lot about some of the things that are coming in the future, and you want to go to, so this is one of the reasons why to go to developer.cisco.com, sign up, register. You'll start to get this information on when innovation centers are opening up. What are the innovation centers doing? What kind of hackathons are going out? What are we doing at Cisco Live? When's Marketplace coming up? What's going on new with InterCloud? This is one place. I mean, Cisco's got this huge website. You can go a ton of places. But if you're a technical person and you want to find out what's cool that's happening with Cisco technically, we always want to get to the developers first and let them know, because they have to know to engage kind of the latest stuff. What should these guys be looking for in the future, technology-wise? Anything that they should sort of be out on the horizon? Any things that we're going to be emphasizing over the future? And I'll leave it to anybody in the group. Obviously,
so I'll start with okay. You know, something we haven't talked about yet. John kind of mentioned containers, but we're really doing some interesting things in the not too distant future with microservices and kind of distributed computing and distributed services across the InterCloud. And so. When I talk about being able to kind of leverage multiple Cisco clouds, partner clouds, and the public clouds, think about doing that across a distributed system of services that are running in the different clouds, but it's one application to the application developer. And so that's taking high availability to the next level with application policy control underneath it. That's going to be very exciting. And that's about the same time as the marketplace announcement is going to come out. So.
Very cool. And I suppose we're going to do some hackathons involved on that, aren't
Absolutely.
We?
Absolutely.
Good. Yeah. Cool. So, anybody else?
Yeah. So from mine's a little bit further out. You've got to squint your eyes a bit more and peer into the distance. But there's, at least in the SB world, there's 5G coming. 5G from a Cisco perspective really means something like name data networking. Name data networking, to your point, sir, is very, very important because it goes from being data to being information. Information is the currency of money. I think that's going to be very exciting. All the infrastructure we're putting in here in terms of intercloud allows us to access that. I think that'll be a very exciting area.
I would add that you probably heard these numbers, but we believe by the year 2020 there will be 50 billion devices that are connected to the networks. And what you would see from Cisco, and I think if you look at all the discussion we had today, is that our focus would be to help you not only integrate the services that run on the network, but also the services that go all the way to these 50 billion devices. So our plan is to provide you with a consistent development environments that can scale with these numbers of devices and take advantage of the end device resource capabilities as well.
Cool.
Yeah, I also want to mention that a lot of our newest software capabilities, we are putting it out as fast as possible on DevNet. So as long as you have a browser, you can actually access that really, really fast. And as you know, that's often the best way to learn about the newest technologies, to play with them and so forth. As an example in the SDN space, for ODL, we have some of the open daylight distribution packetized in a nicer way for you to learn about it and play with it available on DevNet. You also may be familiar with APIC EM, Enterprise SDN Controller. That's also available in DevNet, and the early field trial too. The best place to get it in the world right now is actually on DevNet. That is the easiest place to get it. And as soon as we get to the next version, it'll be out on DevNet ASAP.
You know, actually I'm going to pick on somebody in the back room, and I know him, you know. He'd been trying forever to figure out how I get a hold of APIC EM. And we've known each other forever. He forgot to ask me. He knows I'm developer.cisco. Doug, and how long did it take us to get a response to you that we can get you APIC EM? Less than 24 hours by coming to developer.cisco.com. Yep. So less than 24 hours. Sorry, Doug, I picked on you, but I buy him beers too, so I can pick on him. So yeah, I mean, this is the one place to go to get information, and it should be easy for you. So please hang out there. Dave, you want to add anything else on new stuff?
Jet-powered backpacks and telepathic communication. That's what I'm looking forward to in the future. So related to what John said with the Internet of Things, having everything be attached to the network, I'm really looking forward to the 30 billion things attached to the network, having it be always on, omnipresent, always attached, accessible. That's always the future, bigger and better Internet.
Cool. And then I'll add one last one. We mentioned it early, but I want to remind people for our collab folks, the Squared product for collab, that's going to be the new thing that you're going to see over time, and we're going to be exposing that for developers, so that'll be kind of cool for you too. Hey, guys, this was great. Thank you very much for being so interactive, so willing to talk about stuff that's in the future that may not be announced yet even. Really exciting to have you here. I appreciate it. Thank you all for coming, and have fun out in DevNet, and please, go to developer.cisco.com and register